I'm going to pass along to our featured speaker, Roy Wesley, who is a Sansei born in Portland, Oregon. At the start of World War II, his family lived through incarceration at the Portland Assembly Center and Minidoka Camp. And after the war, his family resettled in Chicago, where he's raised and educated and still lives today. He received an MS and PhD in cell and molecular biology and worked at Pfizer, and received an OD degree at Boston's New England College of Optometry. He returned to the business his father created, Wesley Jensen, the country's largest contact lens manufacturer at the time, and headed clinical research and was president of the National Eye Research Foundation. He's also a research scientist and administrator at Firmalogic Inc. And Dr. Roy Wesley was the 2022 commencement speaker for the 150th anniversary graduating class at the Illinois College of Optometry and was awarded the honorary Doctor of Science in Optometry degree. So we're so lucky to have you here today. So welcome, everyone, join me in welcoming Dr. Wesley.
Thank you, Joy. Wow, what a list you found. Well, I'm really grateful and very honored to be here at the Japanese American National Museum, and especially to be here in this wonderful hall dedicated to democracy and freedom, which is really the topic for this talk, including my dad, Dr. Newton K. Wesley. And I'm also grateful to my husband, Mark Weber, for being here, and my sister-in-law, Vicky, from Chicago, her daughter, Monica, from New York, and her husband, Rob, and their friend, Rory. Thank you for making this long journey to be here in Los Angeles. I'm also very grateful to President and CEO Ann Burroughs, who I just got a text from this morning that she's unable to be here today. But I am very grateful for all of her support and look forward to doing some more continued work with her and Janum. And of course, I'm so grateful to Joy for being the liaison for me to be here today. And Mia Russell, who unfortunately could not be here today, and Kristen Hayashi, who's, I think, elsewhere doing other stuff for Janum. And my thanks, of course, to Dr. Mark Sawamura for being here and for agreeing to be the interviewer for me. One big thank you also to my college classmate, Julie Azuma, who is on the Board of Governors for Janum, and she is the one who made the first introductions for me to President Ann Burroughs. So these days in America, we really find ourselves in a dance and partnership with those who share our perspectives and emotions, or we find ourselves clashing with those in opposition. It's nothing new. What I hope to present to you today is the historical context of the incarceration of Japanese Americans during World War II and its relevance to the culture that we find ourselves in today. You know, the important thing is, how do we bridge this gap in divisive thinking and all the emotions that go along with it? And what I'd like you to think about while I go through this presentation is how the nation is going to heal itself. And that really means, how are we going to be part of that healing? And, you know, we can think about, well, how long did World War II take? What were those racial discriminatory practices that went on? And how long did it take, and how did it happen that healing did happen after the war? So we tend to think that our times today are unique and that things like this have never happened before. And of course, we know that's not true. In some regards, it is true that today is different than any other time in history. But history does repeat itself, and we need to be attentive to the lessons that we can learn from that. So keep in mind some of these following points. There are parallel events to be considered during the Second World War and today. In 1941, the world was at war with Germany and Japan on one side and the Allied forces on the other. There were dictators and absolute rulers, Adolf Hitler, for example, the Emperor of Japan, Hirohito, Mussolini in Italy. The free world, including England, France, and the United States, fought for the survival of democracy. Although Russia was an ally at the time, it was led by an absolute dictator, Joseph Stalin. And today we find that Russia is again headed by another dictator, Vladimir Putin. And he has declared war on the Ukraine with the intention of expanding Russia's territories. We do not know what's going to happen in the future as the United States joins with our allies and in the defense of the Ukraine and possibly other countries. Freedom and democracy were at stake during World War II, just as they are today. Hitler wrote about the big lie, which he called die große Lüge in German, in his book Mein Kampf. He used the term in speeches to distort and misrepresent the truth. Does that sound familiar? We have heard about alternative facts that have become truth. So Goebbels used propaganda through entertainment, news, and radio to win German hearts and minds. America has used the same tactics to convince Americans to support the war, meaning World War II, dehumanize the Japanese, and promote racism. As a result, Japanese American citizens were put into concentration camps to supposedly prevent them from being spies or saboteurs. So the day after Pearl Harbor, President Roosevelt suspended naturalization for Italians, Germans, and Japanese immigrants. 1,600 Italians and over 10,000 Germans were incarcerated. So it wasn't just the Japanese. Sadly, the United States was slow to react to the Holocaust and anti-Semitism at the time. Immigration issues remain cultural and political flashpoints to this date. Divisiveness in the United States existed during World War II and is present today. We may feel that our country is divided today, but Americans mostly agree that World War II was a justified war and that what we did was correct. That was not the case if we go back to the period between 1850 to 1865, the Civil War days, which resulted in bloodshed and the loss of 500,000 American lives. No matter how we feel the country is being divided today, we have not reached the level of irreconcilable differences of 1865. Let's not go there. And with that as background, let's take a look at the life story of Dr. Newton K. Wesley. And please think about some of those issues as we go through this. So in a nutshell, Newton Wesley was born in 1917 in Westport, Oregon, a lumber town. He was the son of Japanese immigrants from Gobo City in Wakayama, Japan. He was an optometrist who had an eye disease, and he developed contact lenses in order to cure his own problem. And that's how he helped to create the contact lens industry in the United States. So that, in a nutshell, is his life. You can go home now. But there's a little more to the story. His parents, who are shown in the photograph on the right, and Newton when he was 1 year old. And so, as you see, he was born a Wesige, and somewhere along the line, he got a new name, Wesley, and I did too. This is the lumber camp mill in which he was born, and in 1917 in Westport, Oregon, and they brought logs down from the Pacific Northwest, milled them, and turned them into usable lumber. His parents, being typical Japanese American immigrants, being immigrants from Japan, went into the typical businesses of either working on the railroad, which my grandfather did, owning hotels, which he did in Portland. And in fact, the picture on the left is the hotel, the last hotel he owned, before the war, which is called the Villa House, and that's actually where I was born, in that building. And he, of course, had a grocery store, which was adjacent to the hotel, a very typical Japanese-American thing to do. This kind of encapsulates the moves that the family did, beginning with his birth up there in 1917 in Westport, Oregon. And then, because my grandfather was farming down here, he developed asthma and couldn't continue farming. So he decided to go up to Portland to develop hotels, and mostly in very bad areas. They were the down and out peoples. And most of the people that they rented to were actually European immigrants. I have seen the census list of immigrants that were in the hotels that he owned, and mostly they were from all of Western Europe. Only one family happened to be Japanese, and that was his family that lived in the hotel. So my dad grew up first in elementary school in Tualatin, and then went to school at Lincoln High School in Portland. He graduated early because he was a very smart boy, and he graduated at the age of 16. And because he was so young, he felt, and he was the smallest kid in the class, he felt that he needed to mature and decided to go spend 2 years doing hard labor so that he could grow up. And he ended up in Alaska in the salmon cannery there. And he followed sort of his grandfather's footsteps and ended up in the lumber mill again in Westport. And so he had to decide, well, how am I gonna live after this? And so his decision was to pick up the Yellow Pages, which was not that thick at that time, only about like that. And started from A and went through the Yellow Pages, and by the time he got to O and he saw the word optometry, he decided, that's it for me. And if you ask him why, well, there never really was a reason given. When he was young, he did end up having eye problems. He was nearsighted and had to go to a doctor who fitted him with glasses, and that may have been part of the inspiration, I don't know. But here is the Hidden Inlet salmon cannery where he worked. And then when he applied to optometry school, it's not a glamorous place. It was right next to the Hollywood Theater in Portland on the second floor here. He succeeded also, and not only did he graduate, the president of the school asked him, because he was such a good student, and the president was in his 70s and decided he needed to retire, he offered the school to my dad for nothing. And this being the Depression, my dad said, no, you can't give it to me for nothing, because that's just not right. So he got two of his college friends, or school friends, and went to the bank and during the Depression, and they were able to get $5,000 to buy the school from Harry Lee Fording, the president. During that same year, he graduated in 39. The next year, he married my mom, Cecilia Sasaki from Seattle. He was playing on the basketball teams at the time and running back and forth doing tournaments. So that's how they met and fell in love and got married. And they had my brother, was born first in December of 1940, and started their family. In 1940, he was also on the board, here he is, of the Japanese American Citizen League in Portland, and he became the president here in 1941. And of course, Pearl Harbor happened, and he was able to give testimony at the Tolan Commission hearings in trying to convince them not to relocate the Japanese Americans. And he received verbal sympathy from the mayor of Portland, Earl Riley, and the governor, Charles Sprague, with whom he developed a relationship then and then for the years after. However, his politician friends declined to vote in favor for not incarcerating Japanese Americans. As a result, Dad's patriotic fervor lasted for the rest of his life, which is also evidenced by this Christmas card they sent out at the time, showing his patriotic spirit. So this order came while we were living in Portland, and it was issued on April 28th, 1942. I happened to be born on May 5th of that year, so just a week later. And the order of exclusion says that we had to be at the Salvation Army headquarters by 12 noon or suffer further penalties or whatever they could possibly do besides putting you in prison. And I have no idea what would be worse than being put in prison. But we were to meet at the Salvation Army headquarters. And that was impossible because Mom was having me. And actually I was born at the Villa House, which you saw in the picture, because our family doctor was already incarcerated. So I was born, and then of course we had to go with all of the other jobs. She was placed in this group with me and my brother 3 days later into this area, which was the Portland Assembly Center, the former Livestock Exposition Center in Portland. And they constructed little 10 by 10 wood plywood platforms covering the manure in the springtime, of course, which was not very pleasant, either smell-wise or sanitary-wise, because there were flies all over the place. We were there, my mom, my brother, and I were there for 3 months when my dad had applied for, through the Quakers and through the help of Mayor Riley and through Governor Sprague, had applied to Earlham College to continue his education. And his desire was that he would become an MD. And so to further his education, he requested that he be allowed to attend Earlham College in Richmond, which is a Quaker school. And that was granted by the government. But my mom, my brother, and I had to stay in this camp in Minidoka. We were transported to Minidoka, Idaho, which is in the desert, central north desert of Idaho, not a very pleasant place at the time. And my mom had to wash me in these tubs in the Minidoka laundry room because the showers were too dangerous to hold the baby because you could, you know, wash, scrub, and then let the baby drop. So tubs were the safer alternative. So we were there for 2.5 years while my dad here pictured at Earlham College. And we were here in the barracks at Minidoka. That's my mom holding me and my brother. So here, as I think about this today, standing in front of my baby image, but me being me, reminds me of being across the street at the Be Here 1942 exhibit. And if you haven't seen that, you really must. It's such a wonderful, realistic travel through artificial reality, AR, into the past. It brings you into 1942, and you can feel and emote with what people were suffering at that particular period of time. So here's me with my mom and my brother Lee. So I mentioned that my dad had an eye disease. He didn't know for several years when he began experiencing multiple images in one eye. And even his own professors at his school didn't know what the cause was. They couldn't optically correct it at the time. And so he went to a lot of ophthalmologists. In fact, he saw 50 different doctors during the period, the 3 or 4 year period of time that his eye disease was worsening. And it took this man, Dr. Eric Fontel, who came from Austria and lived in Chicago, and this was actually his office there, which was just recently demolished, unfortunately, but I got to go there and take a picture of the place where he practiced and where my dad visited before it got torn down. But the reason that Dr. Fontel was important is because being educated in Austria, he was familiar with keratoconus and the fact that in the 1880s, the first case of using a hard glass lens over the eye helped to cure keratoconus. And previously, these glass shells were used as prosthetic devices for people who had eye injuries, for example, from wartime, or disfigurations, or eyelid problems, and you had to retain tears. So there was a history of using these glass molded shells in Europe that didn't exist here. And so his familiarity with it was brought with him to Chicago, where he saw my dad and prescribed the hard scleroplastic lenses, which were large and covered the entire eye. So at that time, he could only wear them for maybe an hour, but there was a miracle. He could actually see clearly because the hard surface of that lens covered up all the imperfections on the front surface of his eye. So that gave him a clue that something could be done. About that same time, he decided to change his name from Wesige to Wesley. It sort of sounds a little bit like that. And the fact that his parents were Methodist and John Wesley was the founder of his parents' church, he thought they wouldn't object. But of course they did. They said, how could you change 1,000 years of samurai history? But he persisted and changed his name to Wesley. In fact, in 1940, his letterheads all had this pronunciation guide, Wes-Sugi. But you see the Wesley part of it there. So after the war, we got restarted in Chicago. There's the family on the steps on the west side of Chicago. He was teaching at Monroe College of Optometry. He's here with two of his colleagues, where he taught and recruited two of his students to help him research contact lenses at that time. That school is now part of the Illinois College of Optometry. And he also set up a practice downtown, and he worked at Northwestern's Medical School in the Department of Ophthalmology, and he did research on contact lenses at night, so he was a very busy guy. So they did their research in George Jessen, his partner's mother's six-flat building here, and they had a lab set up in the basement, and they would melt plastic up on the top in the kitchen, run downstairs, and try to mold them quickly to make scleral lenses. And then they thought, well, maybe we can miniaturize them and cut them down. And so they got an old Singer sewing machine with that treadle, where you use with your feet. And by spinning the treadle, they were able to cut out little discs from the scleral lenses that they were making. Well, they kept refining the process until they could buy a real machine lathe to do the job more accurately, more efficiently. And they moved their lab into an office space downtown. This is actually the office space where they had the clinic in the Chicago Mallers Building, which is part of Jewelers Center in Chicago. So Newton ran the contact lens business while his partner George ran the optometric side, the clinical side of it. They also gave courses for postgraduate work for optometrists coming out of optometry school at the time, because after the war, a lot of schools, including Monroe College, offered six-month degrees to get an OD degree. And that meant that they really had very little training in a lot of the things that they could go into. So they decided they would offer further graduate training so people wouldn't be not knowledgeable about what they were trying to do, and they could also promote contact lenses. Well, that aspect of promoting contact lenses became Dad's passion, and he held patents for this smaller Sphericon lens, which was a small plastic contact lens, one of the early ones, and he would have this rigorous schedule going to different places in the country to give lectures to doctors and also doing public relations, because it wasn't just a matter of training doctors, because schools did not teach contact lenses at that time. So they only got their information from the manufacturer initially. So he also created the National Eye Research Foundation in order to train doctors, give continuing education, and to give information to the public. He was also instrumental in founding the Contact Lens Association of Ophthalmologists, CLAIO. Because he wanted to reach all the doctors in the country, and large airlines didn't fly to smaller places, and for a long time, most optometrists practiced in towns of 25,000 or less. So to reach them, he got his own plane, he learned how to fly, and would do that instead of taking commercial flights to the smaller areas. He also attended in 1956 here in Germany, in the beautiful in Bavaria along Lake Chiemsee. I don't know if you know that, but it's a beautiful location. And Wilhelm Zunges owned this property, and he opened it up for international contact lens research work. Well, he used that as inspiration to have here in the United States his first Congress for contact lenses at the Edgewater Beach Hotel here, which has been demolished. And the lake used to come right up to the back here with the beach. And they had this beautiful model, Anna-Marie Kolb from Germany, who was an actress, and she wore the million-dollar contact lens dress to the final banquet. Well, she had lots of dresses made for her, but Lloyd's of London insured that dress for $1 million. It was kind of a political gimmick. Well, Newton also did a lot of public relations. They recruited football people and other baseball and people who were known at the time in sports who needed contacts in order to see and do the work that they were doing. Actors and actresses like Phyllis Diller, she was actually on our board, and Ronald Reagan, this is before he became president, probably about the time he did Bedtime for Bozo. And he was on a lot of TV shows like the Dave Garraway Show and many others. And he always claimed that he got the word contact lenses into the Webster's Dictionary. I kind of dispute that. But and he was friends with Senator Everett Dirksen, who did a nice piece and presented it to Congress on the company and on him, and it's in the Congressional Record. So the company expanded and grew, and it was a great success, and it was sold in 1980 to Shearing Plow, and then later was sold to SIBA, as has been previously noted, and now belongs to Alcon. So this is the end of my formal part of the lecture, and I just wanted to go back to the beginning and say, what has all this got to do with our freedoms and democracy? Well, I think it's clear that we don't want to have a World War II type incident again. And protection, both in terms of immigration and all of the other divisive issues that we have in our country, it's up to us, it's up to you to create the atmosphere that allows for freedom and democracy to thrive. And so when I thought about this, and I would ask myself, well, what am I going to do? And what would I request you to do? And that is vote. Vote your conscience. Be sure that the people you are voting for are the people who will hold up our freedoms, that will not go backwards. We cannot give up our 14th Amendment rights, for example. And there's so much turmoil going on in the United States right now. There's a lot to watch out for. So I urge you, I urge myself, to vote with that in mind. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And with that, we're gonna transition into kind of the second part of our program today, which will be a conversation between Roy and Dr. Mark Sawamura, who is a third generation Japanese American raised in the west side of Los Angeles. He joined the faculty of Southern California College of Optometry in 1993 and is currently an associate professor and chief of primary eye care and ocular disease at the University Eye Center. He's also the past president of the Asian American Optometric Society. And I wanted to say a special thank you to the current president, Christine Arakaki, who connected us and helped us with this partnership today. So with that, I'm going to invite Mark up to the stage and for a brief conversation, and then we'll go into a Q&A. So again, get your questions ready, and thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Joy, for inviting us here today. And as a representative of the Asian American Optometric Society, we were actually formed 50 years ago by some very prominent Japanese American optometrists from the local area who really wanted to promote the values that were about education and sharing their knowledge with each other, as well as giving back to the community. And so when we were thinking about a place for a 50th anniversary type of party, this was the only place that came up and really in the conversation. So I think it's very important for our history, and so I think we're in the perfect venue to share this message as well. So as you saw, Dr. Wesley really was able to kind of give you a snapshot of his father's life. And I had a chance to read the book as well, and there's so much more. The story goes more in depth about all these different experiences that he had. And what struck me more than anything else was at such a young age, he accomplished so much. You know, by the age of like 21, right? When I'm thinking, what was I doing when I was 21 years old? You know? But he was, right, president of the JCL, and he had already graduated, and he owned optometry school. And so there's all these things that happened during that time period. And then all of a sudden the war hit, and we saw this big transition. And so this is what the book goes into. And so the first question I'm going to ask you is, how did you come up with the title Invisible Vision, right? It's kind of paradoxical in a way, right? And when I read the book, I'm thinking, well, he's a visionary as well, right?
Yeah, invisible vision really referred to the contact lens itself, because from the time that he began his research, nobody could really see that you were wearing contact lenses. And of course, now with the soft lenses, that's even less apparent cosmetically. So that's where the title really came from, was just thinking about how vision can be changed. I mean, there are a lot of implications. And as research goes on today, we now have different procedures. We have cataract lenses that are implanted, and you truly don't see them. They're inside the eyeball, or you might have laser work done, or keratoplasty, corneal molding, whatever you're going to do. Totally different approaches to changing vision without being able to see it.
So when I read this book, I you know, what the impression I got was really it's a story for really many people. We have optometrists who'd find this really fascinating from the point of the development of an industry of a device, right, that is now used worldwide. We have people that could be interested in really business development, right? People are entrepreneurial. We have people who are Japanese American who want to look back in the history of that time and what happened. And so I think there's so many ways you can look at this book and have discussions about it. So I thank you for writing this. But what was your inspiration? Why did you write this book? I mean, obviously your father, right, is a big part of the story. But what made you want to write this book?
Tell you the truth, it was after he died in 2011 that I just felt compelled to tell his story. And that I was compelled because I didn't really know him. You know, being the busy guy, as you've indicated, Mark, that he was, there wasn't that much family time. So I just wondered, who is he? Who was he? Because he was gone by that point. And it took me 10 years of research because I didn't have the facts. So a lot of this was new to me. And I hate to say that, but it's true.
Yeah, that was my impression that, you know, the story really talks about all these great accomplishments. And even my own father, he was dad, right, aerospace engineer. And he did some really tremendous work for the space travel industry, right? Developing thermodynamics and Freon and that kind of stuff. And, you know, to me, he was just dad. It's like, hey, can you, play catch with me or do whatever? And, right, you just don't realize those kind of things that your parents are doing. So when did you kind of know your dad was, right, this giant, right, in the profession?
I think I didn't know anything about that until I was in graduate school in New York. And I met my dad at a hotel on Central Park South. We were going to dinner, walking down the street, and I hear this voice, we hear this voice behind us saying, Dr. Wesley, Dr. Wesley. And we turn around and it was Al Capp. And you probably don't know who Al Capp was at the time. He was a famous cartoonist, and he did cartoons for the Sunday comics like The Shmoo, Daisy May, and Little Abner. He had a whole bunch of series of cartoons, so he was pretty well known. He was a celebrity at the time, and I recognized him immediately because he was so well known, and I thought, how does he know my dad? And it was about then, so I was already pretty old, but you know, like you say, Mark, your dad is your dad. He runs around the house in underwear. It's like, no big deal. Like,
exactly. So one of the things is, you know, that one of the things that you see in the story is your father's journey from, you know, the Quakers, and the Quakers were actually pacifists, and that was the reason how he got to, right, Indiana. Mm-hmm. The Quakers were very supportive of the Japanese Americans, right, and they felt that since they were a slighted population that they could offer some, right, protection, and that's how he was able to make it to Indiana. But obviously you and your brother were in Idaho, and I know he had a chance to come and visit, and one of the things you said, well, yeah, he was, you know, he saw us for the first time, and right, it was kind of a little bit of a shock to actually see you guys there. Do you have any memories of the camp itself? I know you were really, really young. I mean, right, a lot of us don't remember anything when we're like 2 or 3 years old.
No, I wish I did. And one of the things I'd love to do is to be hypnotized to go back to find out what had happened, you know. What are those memories that are so suppressed? And, you know, this brings up a different point, though, but, you know, for many people who were incarcerated, the experience was so bad, they either buried it, they never talked about it, as you all know. And so there are a lot of hidden memories. And I often think that hypnotic therapy could be one tool to help people bridge that gap. Because, well, I'm writing another book on my mom and her incarceration period and how it affected her. She died very young at the age of 56. And I think part of that has to do with the suppression of these feelings that, you know, unless people allow those deeply buried, hurtful feelings to emerge, you suffer from them for a lifetime. And I think she did. I mean, sure, she was also privileged because she had access to money and all the people that she knew in social circles and all of that. But there is a sadness underneath all of it that can never make up for some of those experiences, you know. And I think it's just unfortunate that so many Japanese Americans who probably needed therapy coming out of the camps never got it.
Well, I had half my family, my mother's family was in Poston, Arizona. My father was actually, his family was in Texas, so they were really kind of immune to you know, that incarceration. And, you know, I've been told stories and things over the years growing up, and kind of interesting, you know, now that I was able to read this book, it got me thinking, because I'm just someone who likes to voraciously find out information. And one interesting thing in Minidoka, which I didn't know, that there were actually Peruvians that were in the camp. And the United States government had made a pact with the government of Peru, because there were so many Japanese Peruvians there, that they thought that that was potentially a place where Japan could go in and create a kind of a strategic base. And so they actually had moved some of these people from Peru into the camp, which I found really interesting. And the other thing was, I remember when Paul Kariya, they were talking about him, and he's like, he was from British Columbia, and we found out his parents were incarcerated too. And I'm like, wow, that's stuff that you never hear about, right? Until you actually start, you know, digging deeper. And sadly, as we, you know, go forward in time, a lot of the people that we, you know, that we know that were actually in the camps, right? These memories, like your memories are, right, very scant. It's because, right, a lot of times they were younger people, right? And the people who really suffer the Issei, right? Or the older Niseis, we just don't have their stories. Have you had a chance to visit some of the other camps?
No, I would like to. One camp that's on my list is Heart Mountain because of friends who lived close there. But I think it's really informative to try to learn as much as you can about the camps and the structures and the people and their life stories, because they're very moving, as you've indicated.
Yeah, and even myself, I mean, I drive up and down the 395 to go to Mammoth all the time. And, you know, I always make excuses not to go to, you know, to pop into Manzanar. And I think, you know, that's something I think I definitely want to do. I've seen exhibits in Washington, D.C. at the Smithsonian when they've had that. I've seen it here before. But, I think, and that's one thing I think as a sansei, you know, I have no emotional, I didn't go into the, I wasn't part of that. And as we go, you know, further generations, yonsei and gosei, I think we lose that. We're more Americanized and we don't, right, we don't have the, right, the direct suffrage. And even though, you know, growing up, I had a little bit of the taste of that. You know, I was the only, you know, black-haired kid in my school pictures. But, you know, this is, you know, different. This was loss of civil rights, right? And I think your father was very instrumental in trying to restore those for the people in Portland, right? And he was active in the JCL. Did he ever try to do some of those activities when he was in Chicago that you know of?
No, you know, because in Chicago he was so busy developing his business, staying afloat, you know, trying to make a living when you start from scratch, absolutely nothing. It's a tremendous burden to raise and feed a family of four, actually five or six or seven, because all the relatives start coming in. And many of his relatives didn't have money at the time. Everybody needed a start. And so they would come to him because he was always so enterprising and he could give them starts. So it was a huge burden for him. So he was not involved with the Japanese American community there. But my grandmother, my mom's mom, was definitely, we kind of grew up in the resettlement effort there, which became the Japanese American Service Committee and all of the events. So, you know, the family did, but he did not, because of his other activities.
One story that was in the book was his friendship that he developed with a Dr. Kamano in Japan, who was, right, the father of really the contact lenses over there. And I think what it sounded like, your father was finally able to go to Japan and maybe share that experience with your grandparents.
Mm-hmm. Is that? Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, you know, the Japanese are amazing people because they are so generous, for one thing. And the relationship he had with Dr. Hamano was very close because Dr. Hamano felt that because his whole life and his practice and his family existed because of contact lenses that he learned from my dad. And so he was eternally grateful. Whenever we had events, Dr. Hamano would just fly over. And this is like in the 50s, 60s. He would just come right away and be with us for different things. Drop of a hat. And of course, he always brought all these fabulous gifts, you know, Mikimoto pearls, watches, whatever. It was part of his tradition, but his way of paying back. You know, it's that Japanese spirit and generosity that you, as an American, almost can never pay back to a Japanese person.
Your mother was also an optometrist, which I found kind of interesting. And did she have an active role in the practice? It seemed like, you know, you have pictures of them working together, right? But was that something that she did like full time, or was raising the, you know, the family really
no,
dual role?
No, raising the family was a crucial thing. Of course, her mother helped with family things. Her mom cooked for us. She always did all of the meals. So mom was pretty much able to do whatever she wanted, but she did work in the practice at the very beginning and then later on in her life as well. And I write about that, and there's another tragic story in that, but I'm not going to tell you about that. You'll have to read the next book.
Invisible Vision 2.
Actually, the next book has already got a title. It's called Lost Life. So that'll be a clue to you what happens.
What are some of your favorite memories of your father? I know you, in the book, you talk about, he talks about going on these trips and, right? So it sounds like you were able to, in some cases, jump in the plane and, right, do some of these things.
Yeah.
Go to the Edgewater Hotel.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we had a great life. I mean, he did let me fly the plane once, and that was a big thrill. He had a boat. We had a boat in one of the harbors in Chicago. And so, you know, being a busy guy, he never used it, so somebody had to use it. So I did. We had friends over and parties and stuff like that, and got to know all the boating community around us. It was a lot of fun. So, you know, it's kind of funny because, like for most people probably who make enough money, they don't get to enjoy it as much as the people that their family or other people. You know, I used to, when I lived in New York, and during the summer, you'd walk down Fifth Avenue or Central Park West or Central Park South, and you'd see all the lights are out in these fabulous, you know, multi-million dollar apartments. Nobody there except the servants. They're the ones who could really live it up and enjoy those beautiful palatial places.
Have you ever thought about taking or reclaiming back the Wesugi name at all, or anyone in your family? And right, because it's right, the legacy, right? You have this legacy,
yeah,
of your father, and you know, there's the foundation and all these other things, and you're very active in that. So, you know, changing the name loses maybe that connection, but
yeah.
But you know, a lot of times people go, yeah, you know what, our family name, when we came over, you know, into immigration, we lost that name, we lost our heritage.
Right.
And, have you ever thought about that?
Absolutely, I have. And more recently than not, Mark and I have a son, Craig, who lives in Japan in Fukuoka, and I'm married to a Japanese citizen. And they have three children, our grandchildren. And, you know, it took him 5 years to even meet his wife's family because of that, you know, kind of barrier, being a foreigner. Even though, you know, he has Japanese ancestry in his past, but it's not good enough. His Japanese is passable. Mine is horrible. I mean, I've been trying to learn Japanese for a number of years, and I'm still like beginner. But yes, I mean, to go back to the family name might be very important, just to do exactly what you're saying, reclaim a heritage lost. Yeah.
There was another, you know, going back into those Portland days. He was a very active citizen, right? Even at a young age, but he was part of the reserve fire department, right? He was in the police force, and during that 1942 time, there was a period where there was a lot of civil unrest, and they put the Japanese Americans on curfew. Right. And one of his good friends, actually, Yasui,
right,
actually tested the constitutionality of the curfews. But he was, one of his things that he was supposed to do, because he was a reserve police officer, was to actually be on duty to guard structures and potentially apprehend, potentially his fellow Japanese American citizens. So I don't know if that ever, you know, in the family ever talked about that. That's kind of a tough thing to do. And the same thing about, right, having to sit there and talk to the FBI about all these people, right? Some were Japanese, you know, nationals, and other people were American citizens.
Right. Yeah, it's a very strange story because when you think about it, being a Japanese American, when everybody else was curfewed at 6 p.m., he was not. He was out on the street, supposedly guarding the harbor or the bridge or whatever it was that he was assigned to do, with all of his white workers, other protectors, mostly police and firemen. So how did he get away with that? I have no idea.
Well, it just sounds like he was a very charismatic person, right?
Yeah.
And he just knew people, and that's, I think, that was part of it. But I think that's what made him, right, successful, the drive, right, to be successful. And that goes to that story, right? Just all these things. He had problems, but he always found resources to help him through the problems. And he was persistent, and he knew what he wanted, right?
So just one quick story, if we have time, Joy. But so the one story I did put in the book about Dad, when he had his practice right on the border between where the Japanese lived and the white population. And so his next-door neighbor was a printer named Grossenbacher. And the printer had a daughter who needed some eye services, and so he brought her to my dad. My dad examined her eyes, gave her glasses, didn't charge Rosenbacher anything because he's, you know, like a business person right next door. Well, it turns out when the FBI came to our house, and my dad wasn't home, but my granddad, his father, was there, and they had things, you know, around like swords and things related to Japan and the emperor and all that. And you know, of course, that was immediate cause to be thrown right into jail. However, the captain of the brigade said, no, leave him alone. There's nothing here to find. And when my dad came home and he said, what happened today? And Grandpa told him. And he said, what was his name? Grossenbacher. He happened to be the captain of the FBI group that was surveilling the entire area. So, you know, that little act of kindness paid off for him, kept my grandfather from being shipped off.
Thank you for sharing, yeah. Such a powerful story, and thank you for sharing all these remembrances and this insight. I did want to just transition us into an audience Q&A. So this is going to work in kind of a couple different ways. One, if you are here in person, we do have a number that you can text your question to. That just helps us kind of streamline the questions. And then folks online, please ask your questions in the chat. We can also start off with if anyone here in the audience in person has any questions. Yeah, I'm going to start over here first. Yeah.
Martin stole my question. But
sorry.
But Dr. Wesley, I got to ask, being an optometrist myself, did you decide to become an optometrist through your own parental peer pressure, or was that a choice you made?
I'm going to repeat the question just so the folks can hear. It was a question about whether your choice to become an optometrist yourself and whether that was through parental peer pressure or through kind of own passion.
I'll answer it honestly. I did not want to become an optometrist. My dad was considering, well, the company was running into some trouble at the time that he had asked me to talk to, he had turned it over to professional management, and he asked me to talk to the president of the company at the time and see what I could do to help. The president said, get an OD degree. There's a quick program at the New England College of Optometry with your PhD. You could get done in 2 years. Well, he didn't tell me. It's like 2 years constant work. There was no break, except I think Christmas Day. And so we had a study, and we had to compete against every year. So, you know, when I came in, we were competing against freshmen. By the end of that first year, we were competing against juniors. And by the end of our second year, we were competing against the seniors. So it went very quickly, and they all hated us because we kept pushing the curve the wrong way, they said. So anyway, I got my optometry degree, and then I came back to Chicago, and I promptly sold the company. So why did I do that?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Dr. Ron Wesley, is voting enough to get us out of this darkness and into the light?
You're asking the wrong person.
No, you're a person, and you belong in this society, and you're part of society.
Yes, I think, to be serious.
Who is the right person to
ask? And well, I yourself and everybody else in the audience. Yeah, and you know, I think.
Well, I'm asking you.
I think if we all.
Can I repeat that? Is voting enough to get us out of this darkness and into the light?
No. Honestly, it is not. There's
Do you
a
have
lot.
Any suggestions?
Yes. There are many other ways to influence the culture and the direction that it's going. Other than voting. And a lot of that has to do with activism, people taking on the courage to go out and demonstrate, to do the things, to write to your senators, to write to the legislatures, to do all the things that you hope are going to influence the decisions that have to be made. Voting is never quite enough. In fact, it sometimes gets us into trouble, especially when you have the Electoral College going against the popular vote. So, voting is not enough. There are other things that have to get done in this country to make sure that the agenda that you as individuals want, and not particularly my agenda, but you know, we all have a consensus sometimes, and we want to make sure that that consensus moves things forward, hopefully in the right direction. But we can never be sure.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for the question.
Do we have any other audience questions, either here in person or we're waiting for some to come in from online? Yeah?
Hi, I have a question. Has the U.S. government ever done anything in terms of reparations for Japanese Americans? And do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, so the question again was, are there any, has the government offered any reparations for World War II incarceration? And your thoughts on that?
Yeah, thanks for the question, Rory. Yes, indeed, the government granted reparations, I think during the 70s, was it?
80s.
80s.
They also did that in Canada, too.
Yeah, and it was $20,000 for the people who were incarcerated. But unfortunately, by that time, the people who really deserved it, the Iseis, the first generation of Japanese Americans, most of them had died. And so, you know, not only did they lose that they gave up everything, they did not get any sense of benefit or the justice that they really sought for.
Yeah, and just a, there's a celebration of the 30th anniversary of the Civil Liberties Act, which was what signed the reparations into law. We have a special part of our Common Ground Core Historical Exhibition over at JANM, so definitely for folks who can want to learn more about that. We have a whole special display on the signing and the movement for the redress and reparations. Yeah.
I don't know if this is a question, but it's more a comment connecting both of those last two questions. Like that reparations only happened with activism of Japanese Americans and others pushing for reparations. Like it didn't just happen. And so like I think it's also a connection that a lot of for Black Americans who also have been never gotten what they've been promised by this country. So.
Yeah, thank you. We have a question from online, and I'm going to ask this from Kimberly. In what way did writing this book help you reconnect with your father?
Thank you. That's a great question. If I hadn't written the book, I would never have reconnected with my dad. You know, growing up as a child, you know, you have, as any child would, you have these resentments against your parents for doing whatever it was you felt slighted for. Well, I had a whole list of them. And when I finished writing the book and doing the research, and I realized he is the person that he was, that he tried his damnedest and his best to do for his family what he thought was right. And when I look at him from that perspective, I had to give up all my resentments, all my issues that I had. And so it definitely helped me reconnect with my dad.
Yeah, thank you. Do we have any other audience questions? I think I'm just curious kind of like what were you most surprised by or most moved by when you wrote this? Is there anything, and kind of what lessons do you hope that all the folks who are going to go purchase the book in the lobby and read the full story and have listened to you today kind of learn from this?
I think I was really most surprised by the fact that I enjoyed doing the research and the writing so much. It just became, like Mark says, you become inquisitive. You want to know more. You want to turn every stone over. And it was just life enriching for me. And I would urge all of you to think about your own life stories. You know, there's so much done in genealogy these days to go back in time and see what your ancestors did, you know. Because it tells you, it informs you about your own life, who you are, and what you can possibly become. So there's great value in doing that kind of research, exploring, thinking about it, applying it to your life, applying it to your children's lives, and moving forward.
Yeah, thank you. One last call for questions. anything last comments from you, Mark or Dr. Roy?
I think just, you know, the book is, you know, really, he really went through a really challenging time in his life, right? Where you had someone who was second generation who was trying to assimilate in or acculturate into American society, and then within a very short period of time, he's being alienated by that same country. And we saw that spirit, right, in some of the younger people who were in camp or their parents were in camp and they signed up for the 442, right? Where you had withering patriotism, but they were still, right, incarcerated. And you go, why? How could you do that, right? How could you feel that way when you're right behind bars and there's, you know, guns pointing at you and your freedoms are taken away, but still be that patriotic to go and, right, potentially give your life up for your country? And he didn't necessarily go that route, but he was actively involved, right, in that, right, that transitional period in the patriotism that he had for the country, right?
Yeah. And by the way, he was also hated for that by some Japanese Americans for being so patriotic. Certainly the Dono boys would look at him in a very different way. And, you know, it's hard to judge, but I think he did what he thought he could do for example, in the assembly center. He was on the management team overseeing the entire assembly center at the time. And so he wrote these letters to the governor. He called Letters to Freedom to explain to him what was actually going on in the camp, what was needed, the facilities that had to be changed to try to better the life for the internees. And many internees had turned against him because they felt that JECL had betrayed them by not working hard enough to keep them out. So there was a lot of resentment by even people who would normally have supported him. But he had to face that and keep pushing forward.
And I think this book should lead people to do a little bit more discovery, you know, on their own on this topic. Because, like I said, right, I love to read. Got me thinking, like, how did the Japanese end up in Colorado, right? Mm-hmm. What about these people who lived right outside the camp, right? There were camps in states where you had free, potentially Japanese Americans living, right? How was that dynamic, right? So there's all these things I think we could take from this conversation and enlighten ourselves. I think there's, you know, it's we're looking at history, but also looking, you know, sometimes history repeats itself. And at the same time, I think this book, you know, we always, you know, from an optometrist standpoint, right, we always look to these people who are the giants and I think that's important. Don't forget these people, right? Because and I think we should all be proud as a Japanese American to see someone who's that successful, right, in a very trying time. So I think this story is really, right, uplifting. And to be honest, before this, I knew your father as, I saw a picture of him once when I was in, I think maybe school or right after school, and I'm going, that guy looks Japanese. but his name is Wesley. And he's got these like sideburns that would, you know, that would make an Okinawan proud. Right? But at the time, there was no way to figure out who he was. And so I think this book really allowed me to see him in a totally different light. And just the wonderful things he did for the community back in Portland, you know, family, all these other things. And so I think the book really, right, just goes into all these different angles. So hope everyone gets a chance to read it.
Okay, well, with that, I think we're going to wrap up our program today, but I think just being left with, you know, this call to action for questions and investigation and action is so exciting and so exciting. Oh, I can take my mask off. So exciting for us here at the Japanese American National Museum. And here, I wanted to mention that we are, as we briefly touched on, in the Tatouchi Democracy Forum, which is part of our National Center for the Preservation of Democracy, which is a project of JANM that looks to explore a lot of the questions that we talked about today around democracy and justice and how do we make sure that we are preserving democracy. And what is our role in that? So we're so grateful that we are able to continue to explore that today. And we are going to be selling copies of the books and doing a book signing out in the lobby. So our store is setting up right now. And you can also purchase it if you are online in our store, janumstore.com. We ship worldwide, so you can get a copy wherever you are. And I want to say one more final thank you to our partners at the Asian American Optometrics Association and also our supporters at Okairi here in Los Angeles. And also, can I get a huge round of applause for Dr. Mark Sawamura and, of course, Dr. Roy Wesley here today. We hope that you stick around, get your copy of the book, and also stop by across the museum to explore our exhibitions, including, as we mentioned, Be Here 1942, which has an augmented reality element that is exciting, and we hope that you're able to experience it here today and come back and visit again. So with that, thank you so much, and have a really safe and great afternoon.